name is David Zwingman. I graduated from Palma in 1964.
Where was your graduation? What was that day like?
Okay, graduation was actually in the gym.
It was, okay.
In those days, a large class, my class, including the girls, was 44 students.
Okay. Did you know what you wanted to do next? Did you know where your life was going to take you? Can you tell me about that?
I knew that my ultimate goal was to become a nowadays we call aerospace engineer.
Okay.
And I knew that's what I needed, which meant I needed to have a lot of physics, a lot of math, you know, that kind of stuff, and engineering courses, which I was always good at, so it never had was a problem. And ending up with multiple degrees in the field, plus my walls here are all kinds of certifications up there, but I doubt if you can see those.
I can see them. I can't read them, though. So, but you knew from that age that that was your path that was on.
Yeah, I was actually already thinking about it when I was a sophomore.
Really? Was Palma helpful for you at that point in time, putting you on the right track?
I would say yes, because we had a brother who was in the sciences, Brother Kelly. Brother Rocks was primarily in math.
Okay.
And both of them were, I'm going to just say, extremely good. So they enhanced all of us to do things as far as that goes.
That's fantastic. So I'm going to kind of jump to the present. What keeps you busy today? What are the things that you're doing today that keep you busy?
I'm retired.
So are you not busy?
I've actually retired three times.
Okay.
And
are you getting good at it now?
No, what it is because of my specialty in the aerospace industry.
Okay.
I had retired in 2000, but when they had the major shuttle explosion over North Texas, a bunch of us old engineers were called back to analyze the data. And since it was the dynamics part of it was my area of which expertise, knowing that kind of stuff. So we were locked up in a big building.
Wow.
Whatever we wanted was brought to us.
Uh-huh.
And we're laying on the floor, crawling down, reading strip charts, which you guys probably don't even know what those are.
I certainly don't.
Well, I'll give you a simple one. Go get an EKG.
Mm-hmm.
That little strip that comes out,
yes. That's
a strip chart.
Okay.
This thing was over 300 feet long, and we're on the floor going through trying to figure out where the mistake was and things like that. It even happened later on that they called me back for some stuff and things like that. But all through my career of working at the Johnson Space Center in flight dynamics and all that kind of stuff, I also taught the stuff at a local college.
Okay. Okay.
So I have a lot of young people. I call them young people. They're old people now. Even in my latter years, I still have, and as a matter of fact, last week I got an email from one of my former students who's now in the doctoral program in that field.
Oh.
And I get these messages all the time.
That's fantastic. So let's go back a little bit. Tell me the in-between time. So from 1964 to 2000, what was your journey like when you left Palma? Where did you go from there? And
okay.
You kind of give me the highlights of your life today.
Well, I went on, got an aeronautical engineering degree from California State Polytech in San Luis Obispo.
Oh, that's where I am right now.
And where then I was immediately, this was the era of Vietnam War.
Yeah.
Because of my specialty, I was direct commissioned into the U.S. Army to go to Fort Bliss to work in the missile program for the United States government.
Okay.
And I did do a tour in Vietnam, but wherever I went, I had an army of guards around me. So but that's come here nor there.
Sure.
Beautiful country as far as that goes. But
sure.
When I came back to the United States, I went right back to Fort Bliss in Texas and at White Sands, where I still continued to do military missile guidance and navigation stuff and testing and things like that. After 5 years, I said, nah, I think I'm going to step out. Lo and behold, I'll swear the government called JSC and said, here's an asset. Because next thing I knew, I was at JSC.
Working. Okay. And you spent your whole career there then?
Yes.
That's fantastic.
And I worked, as a matter of fact, when I was in college, I co-opted with a contractor that made the explosive bolts for the Atlas rocket that went to the moon.
Wow.
And I was understudy because I was an engineering student. I was assigned to a professional engineer that ran the organization and that. So I learned a lot from that man, and it just went on from there. And
that's fantastic.
Being a licensed engineer in aerodynamics and space stuff, and I've continued to keep myself kind of abreast of it, even though I don't work in it. I read constantly all this stuff.
Yeah. Wow. Now,
just to finish it off, I've worked through the Apollo program, all of Apollo, the shuttle program from beginning to end. I did the basic dynamics. I was ahead of the team that did the basic dynamics for the space station when it was putting it. I've also worked with scientists all from all over the world. Matter of fact, I'm the one that did all the dynamics for when the last vehicle of the Apollo program, the Soyuz one, where they met with the Russians in space. They had to understand they had to be mating at the same speed, very slow, because if you did not, one was too far off, you'd put the other one in a terminal tumble dive.
Wow.
And so needless to say, our program had a lot of stress.
I can imagine. Now, what in your life at this point brings you joy? What makes you really happy? What are the things that have brought you joy throughout your really long, successful career in life?
All the people I've worked with over my career.
Mm-hmm.
When we first started working in the Apollo program out at NASA, now every year we had one big party. I don't care if you were a contractor or what, your entire family was there. It was one big party, picnic type thing.
Yeah.
And we kept it for years. And just as a side note on that, my grandson last year had to do a report. This is my youngest grandson, had to do a report in his science class, and he drew Neil Armstrong. Mm-hmm. So he when he got home, he told his mom, and she said, wait, call grandpa. He can give you all kinds of stuff on it. And I sent him a couple of pictures and some little notes for his program. Then I called my daughter later, and I said, what would they say if I came over to the school? Mm-hmm. And I brought some stuff for them to see. And she said, oh, they'd probably go ape. So I went over to JSC. I talked to my buddy in the PR program over there. And he says, oh, well, we'll just give each kid one of these. I had a trunk load of stuff for each kid.
Wow.
And just as I was getting ready to leave, he said, and we're going to give you something special for the teacher. They had a picture of the space shuttle taken from the space station, and it was signed by the astronauts. And to give to her.
That's pretty cool.
And he didn't know I was coming. And it was all set up. I would meet my daughter, who taught at the high school.
Right.
At there. And when the principal came over and knocked on the door, and the teacher, like, the principal's coming in to listen and all that. Well, they timed it so he was doing his presentation for me to enter the room. After his presentation, which was real good, I could must admit I liked what he said. I made a couple of corrections for him, but they come here. But then the teacher said, "Would I entertain questions from the class?" And I figured, okay, for a couple of minutes, I'll do it. 45 minutes later, I'm still answering questions from these kids. But and then I gave all the kids their trinkets, things like that. And I said, one more. And I pulled this picture out. And it was a 12 by 16 frame picture as far as gave it to her. It now, my daughter told me it's now sitting in the front office of the school. But things like that. When I was there, I turned to Edward, my grandson. I said, "Why didn't you just ask your mom? She knew Neil Armstrong." And she said, "I didn't dare tell him because everybody knew everybody at that time."
Mm-hmm.
It was just one big happy family. Everybody worked together and their families were included in a lot of things. So if we had a party going on, everybody was there.
That sounds fantastic.
Now I will say that across my career, I did things that we cannot discuss and things like that, which are still, I'm still on the hook until I die.
Okay, fair.
So don't ask.
Well, let me ask you this. Of things that you can tell me, I imagine that you've had challenges, you've had tough times, and again, things that you can disclose. Is there a story that you would like to share that was something that was, you know, challenging, tough for you to get through that you did, and maybe give me a little perspective of that?
Well, I can give you a several.
All right. But one that I don't have to redact later. So,
no, this actually happened when I was working with the Apollo Soyuz. I had my Russian counterpart and I were working on the dynamics of the two vehicles at JSC. Now, granted, behind him, he had his man in black.
Okay.
And basically, he played dumb like he didn't understand English. I knew he spoke it better than I did. And I had learned a little Russian, just enough to understand when he told my buddy, the engineers, that something was keep your mouth shut.
Oh, okay.
But we worked across the table, working out the dynamics of and how they would mate in space and things like that. Well, at the end of our thing, we got everything done. He was in awe of my calculator, an electric calculator.
Okay.
A TI-10.
Okay.
Because they didn't have anything. Yeah, no, I could still use a slide rule. Matter of fact, I got my slide rule here. I use it a little still. And so I gave it to him with some extra batteries in there.
Uh-huh.
And lo and behold, about a month or so later, I got a package in the mail here at the house. And it was addressed to me and my wife. And it was from him and his wife. It was a true Russian bushka.
Wow.
Stacking dolls.
Yeah.
And every one of my grandkids thinks it's the most awesome thing. I mean, it goes from about this high to that high.
Wow. That's pretty cool.
And that was that was one of the best prizes and things like that. But it's the friends that you make through not only just at where we work, we interface all over the world.
Yeah.
So you travel. When you traveled to some more people that were in your field.
So I'm gonna time travel you a little bit here. Go back and tell me about a Friday night at Palma, a football game, a dance. When you were a student at Palma, what was the thing that was fun, exciting, that's in your memory, that kind of maybe still makes you smile?
Well, I enjoyed the sports and things like that, but I think the one thing I remember is the prom.
Okay. Where do you remember where it was?
In the gym.
Okay.
We had to take our shoes off. Okay. We danced in socks.
It was a sock hop.
Yeah. Well, basically, we boys were in pants and suit jacket, and the ladies were, girls were in nice. And you got to remember, back then, the girls had the north side of the school, and we had the south side of the school.
Right.
So we interfaced all the time.
Do you have any classmates that you would like to see do this interview? And do you keep in touch with anyone? Can you give me a name or two that maybe I could follow up and have another conversation?
Oh, gee. I don't remember a lot of the names. Danny Alapaz was one of them. Tommy Faino was another one of my good friends. But every now and then I will get an email from I'm going to call it the class secretary. There are a lot of us that aren't around anymore. That's for sure. I know that. Yeah. But we just kind of simple little emails and things like that. But those are the ones that remember.
Fair enough. Well, thank you again for your time. It was fantastic talking to you, and we'll be in touch.
Okay.
Have a good night.
Good night. Bye.
Brother sun, shine.